Well, we're back again for episode 2 of my Fantasy GP Takeover, the series in which I get a special guest on to take control of my Fantasy Grand Prix team for the up-and-coming Grand Prix weekend. And this week, to take over the Saudi Arabian Grand Prix, is Deanna from Relapped. Hello, Deanna from Relapped.
Hello, how are you?
I'm good, just recovering from what actually turned out to be a really exciting weekend, yeah. Wasn't it? That's just what we needed, wasn't it?
Fantastic start to the season. Really excited for it.
And after 7-8 seasons of sort of predictable goings on, I think it's quite nice to see Ferrari at the top, Mercedes struggling, Red Bull strong, but maybe unreliable. What did you make of it?
We will see. I'm definitely kind of... I never want to say I'm a Ferrari fan, but I mean, it's been Red Bull or Mercedes since 2009 at this point. So I'm definitely ready for a shakeup here. Even if it is just two Ferrari, that's kind of one of the historic teams. So it is nice to see them kind of regain some pace here and come out swinging. So hope for the best. It's just one race though. So we'll see.
Yeah, that's what I keep having to tell myself. This is just one race.
Yeah.
Things could change very quickly. And the next track, the one that you're in control of, very, very different. So not necessarily, you just can't take what happened in Bahrain and transpose it on.
No.
So some of my viewers might be familiar with your channel. Some of them might not. Do you want to tell them a little bit about what you do, what it's about?
Yeah, so my channel, it initially started as me kind of watching and reacting to old F1 races. And that has kind of died down recently, mostly because of my personal time availability, but hopefully in the future I'll be able to add some more of that. But right now, primarily on my channel, I do reactions to each of the races, and I just started doing live streams for that as well. So if you want to come and sit with me during the race, and then I kind of edit together a video and throw up the highlights later on, and yeah, it's just good fun.
It is a lot of good fun. I'm kind of addicted to just reaction videos in general. If I've seen like a cool film, if I've seen a trailer I like, I like immediately go to my favorite people to see. I just like watching people enjoy things I've enjoyed. I've got, if you're okay with this, I've got a little clip. Can I show a little clip?
Yeah, go for it.
You could pick one if you like. I've got one from Bahrain or one from Abu Dhabi.
Probably Bahrain. I think Abu Dhabi, I kind of look like a psychopath most of the time.
I did get a very,
flailing, yeah. I kind of like black out when it happens and then I'm going back and like editing the video. I'm like, this is really what I do. Yeah, it's a great time.
I know it. Right, I'm going to run. I'm going to get over to my Bahrain clip, which I think is this one. Yeah, you're in the hallway. So for people at home, this might not be your most eloquent 20 seconds, but I think it gives an
the whole battle? Oh, I love it so much. Long way. Ooh, barely gets there. Coming back. Doing this again. And Verstappen, he's going again. He's going first. Oh. Stays ahead. Oh my gosh. Leclerc gets it back again. We do the same thing again. Oh my gosh. This is awesome. This makes me so excited for the season. Are we gonna go again? It's so, normally they just get uploaded and I never look at it ever again.
I did see you slowly start to dive in your, it kind of meta, isn't it? Getting you to react to your own reactions. I'm hoping someone clips this now and then gets you another vodcast and then gets you to react to this
bit. Oh God.
And you just get smaller and smaller in the corner.
Nightmare cycle, yes.
I empathize with your reactions a lot because you emote with your limbs.
Yeah. I'm a big hand talker, kind of. I attribute it to, I danced growing up for like 14 years, so that wasn't a complete waste of time. I attribute it to why I'm like this. So, you know, it adds to the whole thing. But yeah, I do love flailing limbs, I guess.
Yeah, I'm one of the people who has to be mindful of where I put my drinks when I'm, if I'm going to be watching Grand Prix. There is a period of time when you've moved to your sofa and you're doing all four at the same time.
Yes. We're taking a little break from that.
Okay, well, we'll stop getting you to cringe at your own content. although I do understand the getting through the barrier of editing yourself phase, which I had to do. And I was only doing audio for a long time. And even then I was whispering into the microphone so my housemate didn't hear me.
Yeah, even the audio, that was because I actually started my channel as a podcast when I very first started it, but it just took me forever to edit it because I was like, I hate the sound of my voice, I can't do this. It takes a long time to get used to.
Do you find that after a while it sort of becomes just a different person, someone else?
Yes, definitely.
That's the only way to
kind of become disassociated. Yeah.
All right, let's chat a little bit. F1 2022, finally got it here. We sort of talked a bit about Bahrain, which I think everyone was pretty happy about. I mean, I don't know if you're a big Max Verstappen Red Bull fan, maybe less so much, but actually, who doesn't love a bit of Leclerc getting a...
Because
we saw a bit of him in 2019. God, the years just fly by. 2019, when he was starting to show himself, and then immediately Ferrari flatlined.
Yeah, it's kind of thinking about that 2019 season. I think the best work that's been done, I think, from last season to this season is definitely from the Ferrari Power Unit team. But it does come with that little bit of hesitation with 2019 still in the back of the mind. So, but hopefully they've ironed out all those issues now over the past couple years.
Yeah, and I also can't help but think of 2017, 2018, where it looked like they were really going to launch a championship challenge and then halfway through so much. Okay, so ahead of looking at Saudi Arabia, I got a little bit of emails from people. If you want to email through at home, send them on to chamber@gmail.com if you want to respond to this episode, or if you want to send more questions in ahead of Australia. But for this week, got a few for you. Wes writes in, even though we've only had one race and we shouldn't jump to conclusions, would you say the new aero rules have been a success? New aero rules have been a success or not?
Again, I'm not going to jump to any conclusion yet, because this is Bahrain's a track that even the 2021 cars were able to overtake at. So I hesitate a little bit, but we did have that fantastic battle between Leclerc and Verstappen, although Leclerc kind of baited Verstappen into some of that, we found out after the race. And then there were some battles up and down the field. I mean, Bottas screwed up at the start, but kind of battling through, kind of got to see him overtake some cars through the field. Same with his teammate, Joe. I think they had a fun little battle with Albon. So there were a couple of good signs. And again, it's all positive so far. Nothing, I don't want to draw any conclusions, but so far I think so good.
Yeah, Bahrain, as you say, a positive track anyway for overtaking. It kind of would always get to set us off on the right foot. But actually, we didn't see them spreading out that much, which I think is a good sign over the course of laps and laps and laps. Saudi, very different experience. Tight street circuit. We'll see how that goes, I think. Mm-hmm. Were there four safety cars or three red flags or something last year?
There were two red flags and four virtual safety cars, if I remember correctly.
Perfect. Well, better memory than I have.
Three or four, something like that. But there was a lot of chaos.
So on that note, Clive writes, hey guys, that's us. Can we expect some more craziness in Saudi Arabia given the new rules and regulations and how early in the season it is? Not like it was less crazier last season.
Yeah. I do think the last season's race is a very high bar to reach in just terms of pure chaos. Because you had all of the red flags of VSCs, then all of the Max and Lewis dramas, and then kind of Massey making interesting decisions and the back and forth with the teams and the radios and all that kind of stuff. So I don't think we'll quite reach those levels again, but definitely it's going to be interesting, especially getting these new cars out there and seeing what they're like at a really, truly just basically all-out kind of track. And they've made some improvements, I think, safety-wise, with pushing some barriers back and rounding off some corners. I think they extended the track and then turn 27, whatever the last one is. So hopefully that kind of improves at least some of the visibility issues and stuff like that at that track. It is weird going back so quickly.
Yeah.
Especially, we weren't even sure that track was going to be finished the last time we were there. So maybe they'll have some more facilities done this time. But yeah, I mean, I'm excited. Hopefully the actual safety has improved, because there were a couple scary crashes between Russell and Mazepin, I think, last year, and same with in the F2 race as well, although that wasn't really track specific. But hopefully it's improved and we get a great race here with these new cars.
I think one benefit well, it depends whether you're just looking for pure entertainment or not. We're at the beginning, because we're at the beginning of the season, we don't have that 8 months of build-up of animosity between the title people. So there's not that kind of simmering tension of them looking to run into each other. So maybe it'll be maybe a bit cleaner, but who knows?
Yes.
All right, Aaron's going to ask, I have a question for you, although I think it'll be a common one, winky face. Do you think Mercedes can pull it back and join the fight? I think this is more in general, not necessarily right now. How and how quickly do you think it can be done? Or is this possibly a two-horse race already?
Well, I definitely wouldn't rule it a two-horse race, because at the moment, Mercedes in second, Red Bull's in last. Although that is kind of without other issues from Red Bull. But definitely Mercedes is clear third. I think they'll pull it back if I have faith in any one team to kind of develop a car throughout the season. It would be Mercedes. But it seems like they might have issues on both the aero front and the power unit front, with all six of the other Mercedes-powered cars being in the last six cars on the road at the last race. So a lot of question marks there, as well as the aero. They're one of the worst cars with porpoising. So I think there's quite a few issues to be resolved. But if one team's going to do it, I think it's going to be Mercedes. So I don't know if they'll out and out challenge for the title this season, but I think they'll definitely get back in it by at least midway.
Yeah, and they could be a very interesting spanner in the works if they're not in the title fight, but they are fighting for wins and starting to take significant points away from the other lot. And that, you just made me think that porpoising could be like a major issue in Saudi Arabia, because they go flat out, but not in a straight line.
Yep.
So, well, we'll see.
I worry for the Mercedes powered cars in this coming up this weekend.
All right, this one's from Michael, specifically for you, and it sort of depends what you felt you've learned from your historical watches. I think so far, at least on your channel, you've watched 79 through 81 for the most part.
78 through 81, I've watched all of them and kind of focused on them. I've watched some before that. They were just like random races from, I think, about 63 to 77 on YouTube. So I've watched random races throughout then, but actually kind of focused on is 78 to 81.
So Michael asks for you, I'd love to know if Deanna sees any parallel driving styles. We hope I could talk, couldn't it? Parallel driving styles between drivers past and present.
Yeah, I think, I don't know. I think it is just so incredibly difficult to compare cars between eras and drivers between eras, just because they have such different machinery. But I do think there are definitely special talents that can adapt to the machinery that they have, and that's what makes them so great. But for that little era that I've watched, that kind of 78 to 81, that's definitely peak Gilles Villeneuve. And he just was absolutely relentless, just incredibly quick. And it was very much all or nothing. And I think in some ways that I think it kind of gives shades of like a Verstappen and maybe in some ways even Leclerc. But I think the kind of most one-to-one representation is Gilles in 79, I think, at the Dutch Grand Prix, dragging one wheel along. It definitely very much reminds me of Alonso and Baku in 18. Refusing to stop, refusing to park the car when they maybe should have. So I just think that kind of never kind of giving up, just very, very, very determined. There's definitely shades there. And I don't know, though, about like overall, I think they're all kind of special in their own ways.
No, I think I agree. And definitely comparing people here to is quite hard. I find, and I haven't watched back as far as you. You've watched more historical stuff than me. Everyone tends to get lumped into either being like a Senna-type person who's just like, grr, speed, and a Prost-type person who's like, I'm going to strategize across the whole race and not, you know, think about whether or not diving down the inside is going to be overall the best one. And I'm sure there's much better parallels to draw than that, but that's as far as I get with that kind of thing.
Yes, yeah, I can definitely see. I think the popular one at the moment is the Hamilton Verstappen and Prost Senna relationship, which I can see on the surface. I don't think I've watched enough from that era to kind of really have an opinion on that, but I can see where people are coming from.
Okay, those are the majority of the questions we got to answer. Should we move on to the actual fantasy Grand Prix part?
Yes, we'll see how this goes. I've never really done fantasy anything in my life. I made a team for like the actual F1 one last week, so this is my second attempt. We'll see how it goes.
Okay, well, we get to move on to the other fantasy thing. What I'm going to do first, we're going to go through how Dre did last week to kind of set you up, because he's put down the original team, but you can get rid of all these people and put in brand new ones however you wish. Now, in real life, if you were playing this game not through a YouTube channel, you can lock in your predictions up to the beginning of qualifying. So, Dre did them the Monday before. We're on the Tuesday here. You know, slight disadvantage because we don't have any free practice or anything like that. So Dre got 86 points. I can go through sort of how it broke down. Verstappen got just 5 points because he beat his teammate in qualifying. Stroll. Mm-hmm. Incredibly was his money bags here, and he got 21 points purely on making out. You get three points for every place you gain from grid to flag, so he moved up seven places. Mm-hmm. So he got 21 points.
Three of those were a bit of a gimme, but okay.
Gasly also retired, but he did beat his teammate in qualifying, so he got the 5 points. And then Alpine and Haas, they got the points that their drivers got in the race, and they got a few points for moving up through the field. So overall, not a massive points haul. In terms of predicting the podium, he got Hamilton and Leclerc to be on the podium, but not in the right places. So only got five each there. Didn't get pole position, didn't get fastest lap, but he did get that there would be one safety car. And he did predict that Hülkenberg would come less than ninth, even though at the time it was Vettel. Because Vettel was still...
Yes.
Well,
still would have been probably the same boat, but anyway.
So he came 10,193rd overall. So that's your benchmark.
Okay.
Oh, I don't know. It wasn't great. We spoke, we know it sort of all fell apart.
Yeah.
Had the Red Bulls not broken down, could have been a very different story, of course.
Mm-hmm.
I will just flag up the points here for people who don't know, or if you are unaware. I mean, I kind of just went through it. You get the points the drivers and teams get. You get points for gaining positions. Points for pole position if your driver beats the teammate in qualifying, and then all those predictions down the bottom that you saw. So these are the current prices of all the drivers and all the teams. You got $80 million to play with. They haven't changed the price at all over the first two races, so these are exactly the same as they were before. The purple ones are the ones you've already got, by the way, who you can change.
Yeah.
I think picking Haas was probably the best thing that Dre did for $3 million, because I don't know if anything stands out to you there before we move on to you picking who you want.
Yeah, I've already kind of mocked one up, but definitely the big one there has to be Magnussen at $2 million.
I think, missing that one was a big one, wasn't it?
Yeah, yeah.
All right, let's go over to the team, and you can do whatever you want.
Okay, so I think I'm actually only going to switch out three of these, although I am a little concerned. I'm kind of throwing all my eggs in the Ferrari power unit basket, but they do seem reliable and quick. So I'm going to leave Verstappen. I'm going to say that they kind of figure out the issues, and he does well this weekend. I'm going to switch out Stroll for Magnussen, even though he did get some good points last time. And then I'm also going to swap out Gasly for Leclerc.
Ooh. Okay. Now.
And then I'm going to swap out Red Bull for Ferrari.
Cool. Okay. Well, that's... I think a lot cheaper for a lot more points. You got $5 million left in the bank. Are you happy with what you've got?
Yes. I tried to figure out if there was a way where I thought there was more value for that last $5 million, but I don't think there is. I think that Alpine at least looks reliable. I'm happy to have that in there. And then the Haas, again, that's a really great value pick right there. So overall, and I would imagine that Ferrari, Leclerc should still be around the front of the grid, and hopefully same with Verstappen if his engine holds up. So yeah, I'm pleased.
Cool. I'm happy to lock that in. I think at this point, being able to get Verstappen and Leclerc on your team is a good shout. Okay, I'm going to lock you in. And no one has used up the whole budget yet. Dre had $1.5 million left. I'm just trying to remember what the Alpine cost compared to everything else. Yeah, I think you're right, aren't you?
Yeah. There's really nothing better than that, I don't think.
Maybe you're not going to spend your extra $5 million on the Alpine, on the McLaren.
With the McLaren? No, absolutely not.
Okay, that's cool. That all makes a lot of sense. Where are we going over here? To me, that was nice and easy, wasn't it? And now for your Saudi Grand Prix predictions, you got to do your podium for the race.
Great. Sorry. Okay, so I think I'm going to say that his engine holds up and Verstappen wins. They were the four quickest drivers through the speed traps, all four Red Bull drivers, even though only one of them made it to the end. and Ferrari were the two slowest, ironically enough. I don't know if that will have a giant bearing on this next weekend, but that's what I have to go off of. But I am going to leave Leclerc in second, because it just looks like the best package right now, Leclerc and Ferrari. And then third, this is my pipe dream, and it's a crazy track. Crazy things can happen, and I just want to see it. I want everything to like keep being positive for this team. So I'm going to say that Magnussen gets Haas their very first podium. It's probably not going to happen, but a girl can dream.
No, I love that as a wild card option. I'd love to see it too, to be honest, continue the streak.
Yeah.
I think you're right as well. I mean, we could have collisions, safety cars, restarts, any kind of weird thing. I mean, he came fifth. See, this is what happened to me. I just cannot remember things 3 days later. fifth in the last race. So, yeah, nice.
Yeah.
I love the way they've drawn his quiff. That's
I know, it's huge.
Okay, that's your podium locked in. This is where I say, this all looks pretty good. I mean, Magnussen, a bit of a wild card, and then 5 days' time, we'll be saying, this was a terrible idea.
He finishes last on the road, something like that.
Okay, let's go to pole, Saturday.
Pole, I'm going to say Verstappen doesn't put it in the wall at the end of his final lap this time, and he redeems himself.
Fair enough, yeah. I wonder if he'll be able to put in a lap that looked as magic as it was last year.
Oh, God, that was awful, because everything about it looked amazing until that final corner, and it was sad. Anyway, fastest lap, we will go for Sainz.
Interesting.
But then, let's go Leclerc, because I feel like if Magnussen comes third, that means something happened to Sainz, so.
Okay,
we'll
fair
stick
enough.
It with that. Okay. And then safety car. we'll just go with.
Okay, just before you answer, just for the, just so you're aware, a virtual safety car is the same as a safety car as far as these counts.
Okay.
But if a virtual safety car turns into a safety car, that's still just one.
I'm gonna go a little aggressive and say four.
Okay, four. That's it. That's as high as you can go.
Actually, let's do three.
All right.
No, okay. I said four. Sorry. This is every time I do predictions, I go back and forth. And anyway.
I mean, you've got time. And, well, this is it. How many cows are going to retire? 0 to 3, 4 to 5, 6 or more. How many actually went out in Bahrain? Was it just
three?
It was just the Red Bull powered cars, wasn't it? Yeah. Okay.
Yep. Let's do 4 to 5. That feels like a nice. That's the nice in between. 6 or more feels too aggressive.
And it's funny though, isn't it? You know, we got new cars. We're at Saudi Arabia, and as someone who watched classic races, you know, having a 4 cars retire in a race would be kind of like a good result. Even as far back as like the early 2000s.
There were 5 retirements last year, so I feel okay about that. And I'm still so shocked. I know the Red Bulls kind of imploded at the end there, but for them to really not have any reliability issues up and down the grid until that point was a lot better than I thought that was going to go for everybody first time out.
And it does sound like it was just a very silly thing that they can sort out as well. We'll see, though. We'll see. One dodgy safety car restart could cause a pile-up. And we'll see. Yeah. Okay, yes. So happy to lock those in. Okay. Yeah. There we go. Those are your predictions for Saudi Arabia. We'll see how wise you will look on whether you can finish higher than 10,000.
Probably not.
overall. Brilliant. Well, thank you very much for coming along and doing these to me. Just to remind everyone at home, Relapped is your YouTube channel. I'll put the link in the description for people just to head over. Next race, we've got Peter Leung, who's a journalist across lots of places. He's going to take over the Australian Grand Prix. If you want to send any emails to him or respond to the nonsense we've talked about already on here, yeah, just chainbear@gmail.com with Australia takeover in the subject line. Thank you very much, for Deanna from Relap, for coming on. I'm going to continue to enjoy watching your race reactions.
Well, thank you very much for having me.
It's a pleasure.